Thank you.
Especially welcome visitors, and we're glad to have you, and it's a thrill to have Hannah with us.
Amen.
Have Hannah back from college and all the way in California. Be sure to pick her brain and see what she's learned this year. And we want to get all we can out of her, right? And I believe she goes to Philip DeCourcy's church over there, so talk to her about church as well as college and see what she's learned there. Maybe we can do some things better here. Maybe she's learned some stuff she can teach us. Anyway, we're glad to have her back. Glad to have you all back. And if you hear any snoring during the message this morning, it's probably going to be an OU student because they just got done with finals. They're still exhausted. And so we're glad for those that are here. So don't criticize them if they sleep in church. I mean, if you've got to sleep, church is the best place to do it. You might wake up and learn something somewhere in between the napping. So anyway, we're glad to have the OU people with us today.
Amen.
Okay, let's go to John 17. I'd appreciate prayer for our family. I think we may have a lot of opportunities to minister this week, potentially. So please remember that, that God would use us. We're going to look in John 17, and we are not going to read through the prayer, the great high priestly prayer of Christ again, although I'd love to do that, but I'm just going to look at verse 24 that we looked at last week, which is the last request of this great, glorious prayer, the last request he makes. 25 and 26, as well as some of the things in 24 we looked at last week, are reasons that Jesus gives for the Father, the righteous Father, to answer the request of verse 24. What a glorious request it is. It's the request that we be with him in heaven. And I love teaching that last time. Wish we could teach a lot on that and just keep enjoying it. But there's other things we need to learn from John. So we do have to move on. But we're going to read John 17, 24, 25, and 26. And remembering that this prayer is preceded by the upper room discourse, the foot washing and all the teaching with that and all that great teaching. It's so deep, so powerful, and so difficult. So difficult to go through, and yet so important for us to learn. So let's read 24, 25, 26. Father, I will that they also whom you've given me be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which you've given me. For thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, this is where we pick it up this morning. O righteous Father, the world hath not known me, but I've known thee, and these have known that thou hast sent me. And I've declared unto them thy name, and will declare it, that the love which you've loved me may be in them, and I. Father, help us to speak on this unspeakably rich section of Scripture. We won't do it justice. Anything we say is far below what should be said. We won't be able to understand it completely or grasp it, but help us to move forward and accomplish the purposes that this is in the Scriptures for in our church and in our lives. In Jesus' name. The British Bible teacher William Graham Scroggie said John 17, in all the Scripture, this chapter is in words most easy and in their meanings most profound. What a combination that is. In words most easy. Oh, I get that. I get that. Every kid can read this and say, I get that. A 5-year-old can say, I get most of that. In words most easy, but in their meaning most profound. Martin Lloyd Jones said, for plain and simple as it stands, and yet so deep, rich, and wide, it is that none can fathom. And so what a combination of precise simplicity and perplexing profundity in all of the whole Gospel of John, and now in this prayer, it even gets more plain and more profound, and it's like, how can you do that at the same time? So, it's really something as we go through this. Now, verse 24, Father, I will that they be with me where I am, and he's talking about the third heaven there, we mentioned that last time, is his final request, and what a request that is. I want them with me forever. I want these people with me forever, and with you, in my Father's house. I want them with me forever. Aren't you glad Jesus prayed that as his final request before he went to the cross? He had to go to the cross to get that answer. That's how much he wants it. Because if he had gone to the cross, we would never be with him forever. Could never be with him forever. And so, this is the final request, and it's a great fitting in to the prayer, but in verse 24 itself, and in 25 and 26 following, we have fitting reasons why the request should be and will be answered. This is amazing. I wonder if we have a prayer like prayer, pray like this. We not only ask for stuff, but God, this is why I think you should give it. A lot of times we just, give me this, give me this, give me this, give me this. We don't give any reason, we just give. Give me, give me, give me. Mm-hmm. Jesus is praying. He's not just getting a list of things. He's praying. He's fellowshipping with the Father. He's interacting with the Father. He's communing with the Father. This is the God-man talking to God the Father. This is deep, 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 deep stuff. And there's still some ways we can grab a little of this and get a hold of it. And he's asked for a lot of great things. He asked for their security. He asked for their unity. He asked for their sanctity. He asked for their victory, for their success, for those that would believe on me through their word. He's asked for a lot of good stuff. But now he asked for their destiny, our destiny, theirs and ours. That they, the 11, and us, 2,000 years people, be with me where I am. Quite a request. Big request. Now, that's a pretty big request. That's a pretty big request. I mean, if you and I came to our parents when we were young and said, I want 20 people to move in with us, our parents would think, oh. How about 2,000? How about 20,000? How about 20 million? It's quite a request to bring all these people home to the Father's house. And it's a big request. So obviously he's giving reasons for the request. Not that he's arguing with God or trying to convince God the Father. It's simply communing with him about this matter, and that's what he's doing. And I wonder if we are so busy asking God for stuff that we just don't commune with him and bring him into it and enjoy that he is with us in what we're trying to ask. I've told this story so many times, I shouldn't even tell it, but when I was a young pastor living by myself, a hitchhiker, I picked him up. And you know what I'm going to say? It was a guy in an orange, no, he wasn't a prisoner, but he had orange coveralls, no shirt. He's hitchhiking. I said, go, I picked the guy up. And he said, I said, where are you going? He said, told me I'm going to Albany and I lived on the west side then, and then I'm going to catch a ride to wherever he was going. And I said, well, I'll take you to Albany. He said, oh man, that's great. I said, I'm really hungry. He said, well, I live right here. I'll fix you a sandwich. All right. So I brought him in my apartment, fixed him a bologna sandwich or whatever I fixed him, and he sat down and ate that, and I witnessed to him. And then he looked at me and he said, He said, thank you for the sandwich. I really appreciate that. He said, do you have a shirt? Well, I noticed he sunburned, and he probably did need a shirt. So I went in my closet and gave him a shirt. He put the shirt on, and he saw some ties hanging there, and he said, do you have a tie? And shock must have got on my face with the last one. I was fine with the sandwich. I was fine with the shirt. I was fine with the ride to Albany. But what I thought, he doesn't need the tie, you know. He didn't need the tie. And say, he said something I'll never forget. I guess I've got the gimmies, don't I? I said, I guess you do. You're not getting the tie. But I will take you to Albany. So I took him to Albany. Now, Jesus is asking the Father for stuff, but it's not just gimme, 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 gimme. He's communing, he's interacting, he's fellowshipping with the Father in this great adventure of grace to human beings.
Amen.
And our prayer should reflect that fellowship and enjoyment of God's presence, not just I'm going to see how much I can get and then get on with myself, you know, and so forth. And that's what he's doing. Now, so here's some of the reasons. I'm going to give you some reasons the Lord gives. And these are precious. These are very, very precious things. Number one, we looked at this last week. We're not going to review it. You'll have to go back and get it if you didn't. The first reason is in verse 24 itself. The Father is already committed to this project. And that's really what 24 is talking about when it talks about the Father is the lover of Jesus who loved him before the foundation of the world, and the Father is the giver of the people to Jesus that he's praying for, and the Father is the giver of the glory to Jesus that Jesus wants those people to experience, and to the God-given people and the God-given glory to converge in the Father's house for all eternity. So the Father is already all in. And what the Lord is doing with this first reason as he's making his request is simply fellowshipping with the Father in the project that was started before the world began. Because listen, if he loves Jesus before the foundation of the world, and he loves you like he loved Jesus, that means he loved you before the foundation of the world in Jesus. And you're asking an old friend. We're talking about God's. God's loved us for a long time, before we had existence. Can you love somebody before they exist? I believe that. I've got a granddaughter. Her name is Leela. It's going to Leela. I got a granddaughter coming. Never seen her. She's in the oven. She'll be born June, around Andrea's birthday. I love her, but I never met her. I'm already praying for her. Never met her yet. So if you can love people that are not even born yet, and you haven't seen them yet, certainly you can love people that haven't even been conceived yet. So God loves Jesus before the foundation of the world, because Jesus is pre-existent, a second person of Godhead. He loves us as he loves him, and that's the love of God. We're going to talk about that in another point. But the Father's already committed to the project. He's the lover of Jesus before the foundation of the world. He's giver of these people to Jesus. He is the giver of the glory to Jesus, that post-ascension glory. And so that's the first reason. The Father's already committed to the project. And when God starts, he finishes. Have you ever had somebody say to you, don't start something you can't finish?
Yes.
I have to. And the point here is when God starts something, he always finishes it. We start things and don't get them done. But what the point is, the Father's already committed to the project. And Jesus is just fellowshipping within that in verse 24. Second, the Father is called here the righteous Father in our verse this morning. Oh, righteous Father. Now, a couple of times in the prayer earlier, he calls him Father. Another time he calls him Holy Father, I think in verse 11. And verse 11 sets up verse 17. He's asking the Holy Father to make them holy, sanctify them, or make them holy through your truth, through his truth. So the fact he called him Holy Father had a special meaning in that particular context. It was setting up something he's going to ask. So he calls him Righteous Father here. Righteous Father. Now, let me do something. I've never seen anybody do it, but I'm going to do it this morning. I want to read verse 25, and I want to read with verse 25 the pronouns and see each pronoun as a repetition of Righteous Father. Are you with me? Okay. Oh, Righteous Father, the world has not known you, the Righteous Father. Oh, Righteous Father, the world has not known you, the Righteous Father, but I have known you, the Righteous Father, and these have known that you, the Righteous Father, have sent me, and I've declared unto them your name. Your name is the Righteous Father. How do we know God's righteous? Because through Jesus, he that's seen me has seen the Father, right? And I've declared unto them your name, the righteous Father. That's the name he's talking about in verse 25. And what declares God's righteousness more than the cross of Calvary? And will declare it, and that, of course, is at the cross of Calvary. And the love with which you've loved me may be in them, and I in them. The love that you, the righteous Father, have may be in them, and I in them. Now, God is both righteous and loving. Isn't that what you get in these requests, in these verses?
Yeah.
It's really high talking about his righteousness and his love. His righteousness and his love. He calls him the righteous Father because that's the controlling attribute. Righteousness is holiness in action. And the picture here of righteous Father is that the righteousness controls the love, but it's a precious thought here. The righteousness is the main thing. So we're talking about God's righteousness, the Father's righteousness, and the Father's love are front and center in these last verses. Both are a deep reality to the Lord Jesus Christ. As he goes to the cross of Calvary, he is understanding and grasping God's inflexible righteousness, because that's why the cross was necessary, and his infinite love, that's why the cross was provided. And so God is a God of inflexible righteousness. He's not going to compromise to get anybody into heaven. No illegal aliens in heaven. I'm talking about heaven citizenship, right? You got to be a citizen of heaven. You could be an illegal alien in America and go to heaven. But if you want to go to heaven, you got to be have heaven citizenship. And we are heaven citizens, according to Philippians chapter 3. We got to go through the pearly gate. You can't go under the gate, over the gate, or under the wall, over the wall. Can't do it. So, but here he calls God righteous Father. Now, he could have said loving Father, but he said righteous Father. He could have said merciful Father, everlasting Father, almighty Father. But he chose to say righteous Father, especially here. One said the entire prayer is based on the righteousness of God, who will vindicate the Son by glorifying him. Another said with Jesus' betrayal, innocent suffering, imminent, he affirms the righteousness of God, his Father. His righteous Father is getting ready to execute him, and Jesus affirms his righteousness and his love. He loves me. He loves you. He loves me and you. And therefore, I'm going to the cross. Because his love for me and his love for you, and it's a righteous love. John Brown said, justice required that his request should be granted. That's what's really going on here when he calls him righteous Father. I am not asking you anything that's illegal or unbiblical or unlawful. You are righteous Father, oh righteous Father. So the request he's giving, as powerful as they are, the people like us ought to be in the Father's house forever with Jesus and behold his glory. It's not an unrighteous request because of the cross of Calvary. It would be apart from the cross of Calvary, apart from the death of the Son. And one German writer said that the Christ is in this prayer using righteous Father. He's absorbed. He's absorbed with that idea. The righteous Father. I think so. He's going to the cross because God is righteous. And there's no unrighteousness in him. So, and then George Newton said, Jesus Christ came to him as a righteous God and looked upon him as righteous God when he was making his petitions to him. So one of the most basic attributes of God is righteous in all his ways and holy in all his works. In Psalm 9:8, he's going to judge the world in righteousness. In Psalm 7:9, he's the righteous God. He is not like the unrighteous judge in Jesus' parable on prayer. In Luke 18, he's the righteous Father. He's the righteous judge. And Paul himself, at the end of his life, comforted himself when he was getting ready to have his head chopped off by unrighteous Nero, the emperor of Rome. All right, I'm going to trial. They're going to kill me. I've run the race. I finished my course. I kept the faith. And I got a crown of righteousness coming from the righteous judge. What a statement that is in 2 Timothy. 4:6-8. And so, I want you to think about this. We are living, you young people especially, are living in an age, the neo-atheist people writing books that they're flying off the press, where they call God a moral monster and all that kind of stuff. They're down to ad hominem arguments now, right? They've been whipped so bad, they're down to ad hominem arguments. The point is, we're not going to argue whether the Bible's inspired or not. We just don't like it. He teaches bad things, and God's a bad person, and we don't want to be like him. We want to be like him. They're down to that kind of street trash talk. The trash talking God, that's how bad it is for the unbelieving neo-atheist. And they're very articulate in it, and some people here may believe it. Now, this person's pretty profound. They're pretty deep. They're pretty smart. And so if they say it, there might be something to it, and then their faith is overthrown. Listen, I just want to say this. They have all kinds of bad things to say about God, what he does in history and all that. And of course, they have to misrepresent it to say what they say. And they find fault with the God of the Bible. That's not a new thing. I just want to say, whether it's old critics of God or new critics of God, Jesus, who knows him best, who's been with him for all eternity, who's now going to go to the cross and be treated terribly by his enemies, knowing that that's planned by God and purposed by God for the salvation of men, but knowing that beyond that is the resurrection and ascension, and every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, knowing all of that, he who knows God the Father best, better than any 21st century neo-atheist, Jesus says, calls him righteous. You're a righteous father. Loving father, too. He extols his love and his righteousness. No complaints on his part. Now, I want to tell you something. If he's not complaining, he shouldn't be complaining. God's not treating me right. Oh, you don't want your rights. You had your right to be in hell. Don't forget that. just don't forget that idea. God's not treating you right. If Jesus could pray like this when he went to the cross and celebrate the inflexible righteousness of God and the infinite love of God, even if you don't understand that, just follow his example and take it. He knows more about God than I know, and I'm okay with his view. And I want to tell you something. This was a great comfort to our Lord. If I had to go to court, get misrepresented, and have people murder me and torture me before they killed me, and know that somehow God was going to bring it all good out of it and for my glory and the salvation of the world, what a consolation that'd be. And Jesus is all there for this. He's in on this. This is Jesus' version of what Abraham said 2,000 years before. Shall not the judge of all the earth do what? Right. That's Jesus' version of Abraham. And the cross was a tremendous manifestation of the righteousness of God. He justifies us in such a way that he maintains his righteousness. Romans chapter 3, don't turn to it except in your mind because I'm not going to be there that long. But in Romans chapter 3, it says in verse 23, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Now, you may not say that about yourself, but God says it about you, so get used to it. All have sinned, and you're part of that all, and I am too. And are coming short, that's present tense, of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that's in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are passed through the forbearance of God. To declare, I say at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just or righteous and the declarer righteous of him who believes in Jesus. The cross of Calvary is the ultimate declaration of God's righteousness. He won't let sin slide. He's not going to bend the rules. He's not going to make exceptions. He's going to follow his law. Everything's legal. Everything's up front. Everything's right. No underhand bribes, anything like that. So God's inflexible righteousness is counted upon as a reason for God the Father to hear this petition to get people like you and me into heaven. He's counting on God to do the right thing. So, number one, the Lord, his Heavenly Father, has already committed the project. Two, he's the righteous Father. And let's go back to John 17. So how does this work? How does this work for the righteous Father to do what Jesus is asking him to do? Just what's righteous about the Father in getting us into heaven? Seems like the angels might present it. We're holy, we're sinful. How can they get to come in here? God doesn't smuggle anybody into heaven under the noses of Gabriel and Michael and the holy angel. You go right through the pearl gate. They have angelic righteousness. We have the righteousness of God put through our path. All legal. Paperwork in order. Sin has been dealt with fully. More than if you spend eternity in hell. Jesus died on the cross, paying for your sin completely. The righteousness of God put to your account. That's justification. So, how does this work? Watch what he says. He's filling it out here. O righteous Father, the world has not known you. The world has not known you. A vast amount of people don't know you. They know about you. They know more about you than they want to know. And they hold down the truth in unrighteousness, as Romans 1 says. Because that which is known of God is made manifest to them. They know a lot about God. They know more about God than they want to know. And they hold it down. Depart from us. We don't want the knowledge of your ways. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. And all that stuff that Psalm 10 talks about. In his thoughts, there's no room for God. Crowded out, crowded out. Don't want to think about it. I want to be my own God. So, atheism is a more a moral matter than an intellectual matter, really. It's all twisted up together. So, what he's talking about here is the world does not know you. They don't know you. And that's including Jewish people that don't know you. As Isaiah said, the ox knows its owner and the ass the master's crib, but my people don't know. They don't know that. But in contrast to the world, he says in verse 29, but I know. I know. And there's somebody else that knows. I've known you, and these have known that you've sent. So he's talking about the these there are the people he wants in heaven. Who are swimming against the current. Right? Everybody else is going the own way. There's no God. The God of the Bible is not the real God. They're swimming against the current. And so dead fish can go downstream. Living fish have to go upstream. You know, we're swimming against the current of a culture and everything else. You go with the flow, it's because you're dead. If you can swim against the current, that's a good thing. And so what he's talking about, in contrast to everybody else down here, the world was made by him and the world knew him not. I know you. And these have known that you sent. So there's a difference between us and them. So Jesus is not trying to bring a bunch of people in heaven who don't know God, who have no affinity for God, who have no love for God, who have no interest in God, who have hatred for God. He's bringing people into heaven who used to be that way, but now by God's grace and sovereign mercy have been saved and given to Jesus. And there's a difference now between us and what we used to be and others, what they still are. This is very similar to Abraham and his prayer about Lot in Sodom, right? Bargaining with God, dickering with God. Is there 50 in the city? Will you destroy it? Will you destroy the righteous with the wicked? They'll judge all the earth. Will do right. If there's 50 righteous in there, will they die because of all the wicked? No, the judge of all the earth will do right. And God said, if there's 50, I won't do it. Okay, God, how about 40? How about 30? How about 20? How about 10? What if there's one family? Large family. Because he was really praying for Lot, right? He wasn't using Lot's name, but we know where he was going. Lot didn't have 10 in his family. He probably, if he's counting all the sons-in-laws and everybody, he might have had, but there weren't 10 righteous. And so God answered the prayer anyway, though. He couldn't save the city, but he did get Lot and his family out through Abraham's prayers. Because God won't destroy the wicked and the righteous together. God knows who is his. The Lord knows them that are his. Isn't that what the Bible says? And he knows who knows him and who doesn't. This is life eternal, that they might know you, Jesus Christ, his son, and that might know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom he sent. So there are people who know you, and there's people that don't know you, and God's not going to treat the ones that know him and those that hate him the same. It's kind of like the two spies, Caleb and Joshua. Did they get treated the same as the 10 guys that lied and didn't believe? No. It wouldn't be just for God to do that. It wouldn't be righteous for God to treat Caleb and Joshua, who stood up to everybody else and said, we can go in, there'll be bread for us, and you know, we got it. And the other guys just basically encouraged unbelief. So C.K. Barrett said, by God's righteous judgment of the world is shown to be wrong, and Jesus and the disciples right in their knowledge of God. A.T. Robertson, the righteousness of God is appealed to like God's holiness in verse 11. And B.F. Westcott, two facts are equally true. It's true that the world knows not God, and it's true that these know that you did send me. So it's a matter of justice. It's a matter of justice. It wouldn't be just to say, well, we're going to shoot y'all. We're going to shoot y'all. That's it. So Everett Harrison said, he is righteous, number one, in excluding the world from that glory because it's not known him and therefore does not love him, and so can have no place in the final unity. Two, in including those who have come to know him through the knowledge of Christ as important. So what a precious thought. You know, Noah's faith in building the ark condemned the world, right? Hebrews chapter 11. So the fact that he did have faith and did believe by God's grace was showing others should have, but didn't. And it's because of God's righteousness that he treats both groups as he does. So the Father's already committed to the project, and the Father's the second. The Father's the righteous Father who will do the right thing, first for Jesus, then for those who know he sent him. Christ rejectors and Christ followers are not treated the same as Christ understands and accepts. Third, there's a third reason given here. The Lord Jesus is going to next talk about love. He's going to talk about the intimacy that the people he's praying with, who are now on earth, already enjoy with God, and God enjoys with them. He's using that current intimacy to as a reason why the Father should bring them to his house. Notice what he says. Let's go back to verse 25. O righteous Father, the world's not known you, but I've known you. These have known that you have sent me, and I've declared to them your name and will declare it. And that's the last 2,000 years he's been doing that. That the love with which you have loved me may be in them and I in them. So down through the ages, there's going to be new people that are going to experience God's love for them, loving them the way he loved Jesus. And there's going to be new people that have Jesus in them. Now that sounds very strange, this Jesus in them stuff. If Jesus, he's either mental or he's God. There's plenty of people have mental illness that think somebody's in them, right? But our Lord Jesus is not a mental case. He is a person who is totally healthy, and he's a person who's saying things because he's God himself. And so what a precious thought this is for him to say stuff like this. We couldn't pray like that. But he's talking about the love you have for me, you're going to have for them, and I'm going to be in them. So God the Father's love for God the Son is already on them, and God the Son already dwells in them, and therefore they have an intimacy with God that other people don't, that they didn't have. They have a new affinity with God. They have a new intimacy with God the Father. And therefore, they're going to fit in the Father's house. They're not going to wreck the place when they come in. They're going to be welcome there, and because they're already prepared inside for that place. One writer said the last verse of chapter 17 explains why believers should be ultimately united to Jesus, namely because they have been intimately united to Jesus during their stay on earth. So, isn't that why you want to get married, right? I mean, think back, you married people. You're courting somebody, you're dating somebody, and you begin to feel like, I'm one with them already. They're already the love of my life. Why are we living in two different places? Well, let's recognize what's happened. Let's get married and live together. So that's the picture here. And by the way, this is covenant language. This is the same night the Lord's Supper was given, although it's not mentioned in John. This is initiation of the new covenant. In the old covenant, God had the Shekinah glory dwelling with the people on earth. In the new covenant, we have Christ in us. And the picture here is the love we experience now we'll enjoy in heaven. So it's not just a righteous thing, it's a loving thing. It's not just a love thing, it's a righteous thing. There's nothing unrighteous about the love that God has, the righteous Father has for the Son or for us. There's nothing illegal. No one's smuggled in. No one's illegal in the eyes of the holy angels. We enjoy a legal right to heaven. If any holy angel comes up to me and say, what are you doing here? Oh, you don't know? I've been justified by faith through what Jesus did at the cross. I'm justified by his blood. I have the righteousness of God. What do you got? Well, I have angelic righteousness. Oh, I've got God's righteousness. I don't deserve to be here. Never would if I lived to be 10,000. But it's put to my account because Jesus went to the cross for me. He who knew no sin was made to be sin for us that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. The righteousness of God is put to my account. That's better than human righteousness, better than angelic righteousness. I couldn't get any better position. So don't say anything more to me about it. Very important for us to know we enjoy a legal right to heaven. A legal right. A legal right. Nobody's going to check and kick me out and so forth. It's a precious thing. Now, what this is saying is all the benefits of being a Christian and being saved are not just for this world or this life. Those benefits are extended into the next world. Now, many of you are working, and you know how the work world works. Some give you a very high salary but a terrible retirement, right? Some give you a very good retirement but a pretty weak salary, right? It's the way it works. It seems like people get one or the other. It's rare to get a good salary that you can live on and a good retirement that you can live on, get both in the same job. If you find that job, you better grab it, right? So those are rare. But what we're talking about here is there's benefits in this life. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Big benefit. Big benefit. Father loving me the way he loves the Son. Big benefit, I'm telling you, because he loves the Son. That's huge. And we have unimaginable intimacy with the righteous Father and the living Christ in this life, but that doesn't stop. It's not even close. It's not even the most important. We have an eternal destiny in the Father's house in the next life. Don't forget that part. Don't forget that part. Don't question the Judge's love for you. Don't question any of this. This is good stuff. Now let's go back and think about the Christ in us now, Father loving me now, all that stuff. Thomas Manton wrote volumes on John 17, and he said, if an earthly king lie but one night in a house, what care is there taken that nothing be offensive to him and that all be neat and sweet and clean, right? If you had the governor of Ohio come to your house and stay one night, even if you didn't vote for him, you didn't like him, you'd at least want to put your best foot forward. It's the governor. How about the president? Even if you didn't vote for him, didn't like him, the president of the United States is going to be in my house one day. At least I'm going to clean up my house and make sure there's nothing that's going to be, it might not be much, but it's the best I got. That's the way we act, right? So that's what Manton was saying, writing 300 years ago. If an earthly king lie but one night in a house, what care there is taken that nothing be offensive to him and that all be neat and sweet and clean? How much more careful ought you to be to keep your hearts clean, to perform service acceptable to him, to be in the exercise of faith, love, and other graces, that so you may entertain as you ought your heavenly king who comes to take up his continual abode in your heart. Wow, that's high stuff, isn't it? I got that now. And so in these last verses, he's kind of coming back from the next world, coming back into this world with the 11 and then those that believe on him in the 11 and reminding you already got some pretty great stuff now. And that's a reason for getting me more later. Holy Spirit's called an earnest of the purchase inheritance. We got some down payment on what God's doing, and that's all it is. Alexander McLaren, writing on verse 23 about God's loving us the way he loved Jesus, that's one verse before 24, but it's repeated in 26. He said, we are touching upon heights too dizzy for free and safe walking, on glories too bright for close and steady gaze. I like that. It's like, this is really high stuff. How can I begin to grasp it? He said, but where Christ has spoken, we may reverently follow. Mark then the marvelous thought of the identity between the love which was his and the love which is ours. From everlasting, that divine love lay on the eternal word, which in the hoary beginning, before the beginning of creatures, was with God and was God. The deepest conception that we can form of the divine nature is of a being who in himself carries the subject and object of eternal love, which we speak of in the deep emblem of the Word and the God with whom he eternally was. That love lay upon Christ without limitation, without reservation, without interruption, finding nothing from there from which it recoiled and nothing there which it did not respond to. No mist, no thunderstorm ever broke that sunshine. No tempest ever swept across that calm. Continuous, full, perfect was the love that knit the Father to the Son. And continuous, full, and perfect was the consciousness of abiding in that love, which lay like light upon the spirit of him who said, I delight to do your will. The Father has not left me alone. And then he wrote. Then he wrote. Listen. All that love Christ gives to us is deep, is continuous, is unusual. Our consciousness of God's love is meant by Christ to be like his own. He wants us to be conscious of that abiding, continual, everlasting love in our life down here, the way he was. There's no break in that. There's no diminishing of that. In you. I offend God plenty of times. I offended him this morning before I even got dressed. I hate it when I sin in some way. And so, but a lot of times we do. It may be in our thoughts or something said, but we do, and then we think, oh, so now I got to get confessed that, so I got to get right. I can't preach with that sin on my heart. So, but we do. And so, therefore, God still loves us. And so, we're back in the here and now, and this wonderful love is going on. Now, have you ever heard somebody say, I love him as my own? I love her as a sister. I love her as a mother. I love him as a brother. God loves us. He really loves us as his son, his eternal son. I can't get my heart around that. But there's a point here. The work of salvation has already begun. It's already in process. It's already taking place. And we've already been taken out of the world, and we're hated from the world because of that change already. And we already now, even as weak as we are and foolish as we are and inconsistent as we are, have a heart affinity for the Father's house, Father's ways, and a heart response to Father's love. And so what Jesus is saying is, you're loving them already, and my living in them already manifests a compatibility between them that wasn't there before but is there now. And so, Father, I will. They be with me. So I am. So that intimacy can continue on a more higher level. Is there beholding present tense, my dear? Now, as we close our study on this chapter, I just want to make some applications and observations, because it's been a long